Infosys provides world-class online IT training, staffing, and software testing solutions to customers worldwide. H2K Infosys, how we are different from our competitors. 100% job-oriented training, hands-on project work, cloud test lab, resume preparation and review, mock interviews, robust syllabus, one-time fee and lifetime access to classes, access to recorded sessions of live classes. H2K Infosys has won the trust of thousands of students worldwide. For a free demo class, visit us at h2kinfosys.com.
Results.txt file, and it will say like, okay, fine, thank you client for your question. So your blocks have been stored in these corresponding data modes. You can very well go and pick those blocks. So if you take particularly for block A, it will go to data node 1, 5 and 6 to pick that particular block. And again the block B, it has to go for data node 1, 8 or 2. Okay. So it will, for block D, it will go to data node 8. And same is the case with block C. For block C, it will go to data node 5. So it will read all the three blocks, block A, block B and block C. So finally, we will club all the three blocks to get the block location of results.txt file. So as of now, I am talking about only the fair and smooth process only. So the question here is, what everything is going well? So this is the process if everything is going well. We will talk much more about the failover managements and what if one particular data node or block, or what if one particular daemon is not working properly. So we will see all those failover cases. But as of now, let's concentrate on only the good procedure that is happening. So for any of the operation, name node is the only target that client can talk with to get the information, because the name node is the only guy who is having all the metadata information, like which block is stored in which data node and all those types of information. And also, if you see the metadata here that is corresponding to the name node, the metadata is stored as results.txt file. For block A, it is on data node 1, 5 and 6. And for block 6, it is on data node 7, 1 and 2. And block C, it is on data node 5, 8 and 9. What actually happens is, the block A, to getting the block A, it will first goes to only data node 1. Whenever the data node 1 is not able to provide that block A, then only it will go and talk with data node 5. So this is what the pipeline it follows. So it will be first going to data node 1 and ask for the information. And in any case, if it's not able to get that information from data node 1, then only it will go to data node 5. The same is with block B. First it will go to data node 7 and it will try to get the information. If it's not happening properly, then only it will go to data node 1. So if everything goes in a fair procedure, block A will be written by data node 1, block B will be written by data node 7 and block C will be written by data node 5. So is this fine with everyone? Okay, so then let's move on to the next slide. Okay, thank you Rahul. Okay. So the next slide talks about data node reading files from HDFS. So sometimes a particular task might be given to a data node and that particular data node might not be having that data node. I mean that particular data. Suppose a new task, suppose this count of, we had seen the question like how many likes had been given to particular state. So if that task is assigned to data node 3, and if you see here, data node 3 is not having any information. It is not containing any of the block. So at that moment, what data node 3 needs to be done is, it has to go to another data node and it has to read that information. So what data node 3 says is like, tell me the locations of block A of file.txt. So then what it will do is, it will first try to check in the same rack whether that block A is available. So if you see the rack 1, data node 1 is having the block A. So the first thing where data node 3 goes is, it will go to data node 1 and asks for block A. So if data node 1 is able to give that information, it's fine and it will process that particular task. If data node 1 is not able to give block A, then the data node 3 will go to data node 5 here, which is mentioned in rack 5, to get that block A information. So this is how the data locality will happen. So first of all, the priority is given to data node in that rack itself. If it's not available, then only it will go to different rack to get that information. Am I audible, guys? Akshay, am I audible now? Is it still breaking? Okay. So you are able to hear me, right? Okay, thank you. Sure, I will repeat this slide, okay? This slide talks about data node reading files from HDFS. So sometimes what the requirement will be like, a particular task might be given to a data node where it doesn't have that data node, data itself. So if a task is given to data node 3, and if you observe this slide, data node 3 is not having any of its blocks, right? It doesn't contain block A, block B or block C even. So, but still, the job writer has given a task to this data node, as it seems to be available. So, what data node needs to be done is, it has to read these blocks from other data nodes. So, what it questions is like, tell me the locations of block A of file.txt. First, the function what it does is, it will try to get that information in the rack where it is present itself. So it will try to check in data node 1 and data node 2. So once if it goes to data node 1, it is able to see that block A in data node 1. So it will copy this block A to data node 3. What if this particular block is not found in the whole rack? So that's what the point is. So then it will go to different rack and try to check, right? See, if a particular data node is given any task, it has to process that information, right? So in order to process that information, it has to know like where the data is available. Under what circumstances would a data node want to know about conditions? Rahul, my answer fine with you, because I mean, if any particular task is assigned to a data node, it has to search for the blocks that contains that information, right? Okay, fine. Thank you. So this is how the data locality happens. First of all, the priority is given to the data nodes that were present in that rack itself. Until and unless it doesn't find the data in It finds the data in that rack, it is okay. If it's that data is not available in rack 1, then only the data node 3 will go and what would the same thing? Okay, hold on guys, one second. Yes, the same thing will happen, Rahul. Yes, if any data node is added after its failures, those data nodes needs to be, those blocks needs to be copied. So don't worry about failures. We will talk about failures after the correct process is finished, okay? Why would job tracker assign node 3 when name node says info is in? So let's think like the name node which contains information is already processing so many jobs and it is not it's not able to take any other new task because it's completely busy with the task that was assigned to it. Then job tracker has definitely looked for the data node which is not doing any task, right? Fine, Krishna? Okay. So this is the next one. This particular slide talks about the functionality of name node. So as we discussed in the first day of the master-slave architecture, we had seen few terms called as heartbeats, right? So we will discuss what a heartbeat is about. So whenever a data node is active or whenever a data node is functioning properly, a particular set of intervals, it will give an acknowledgement in the form of heartbeat to the name node saying that I am alive and I am having this information. So suppose if you take data node 1, the data node 1 will give acknowledgements to name node stating that I am alive and I am having the blocks A and C. So at every 10th heartbeat, the name node will make a note of the report and it will update its metadata like, okay, data node 1 is having block A and C. So this is how the acknowledgements is being given by each of the data node, so that name node will update its metadata whenever there is a change or whenever there is exchange of blocks between data nodes. Okay. So that's what this slide talks about. Data node sends heartbeats and every 10th heartbeat, name node will have its block report and name node builds metadata from those block reports. So once the information is given by data node, it will update their metadata and also the files like, okay, what are the blocks that were making up that particular file. And this TCP every 3 seconds means there will be a protocol that will be acting between the name nodes and data nodes, not only between the name nodes and data nodes. So any communication will be passed through this TCP protocol. So you guys don't need to worry about these protocols because the admin will be taking care like whether these protocols have been sent properly and if there is proper communication between them or not. Okay, but if we talk about, yes, there is no backup if the name node is gone. So that's the reason we are maintaining a different process called as secondary name node. What secondary name node does is it will, in particular intervals of time, it will update the metadata information of name node into its RAM. So whenever there is a failure to name node, definitely HDFS is down and admin has to set up physically another data node as a name node taking the information from secondary name node. So, but in a typical architecture, people will maintain in such a way that name node will never go down. So, there definitely they will take assurance like it will not go down. But in some cases or some bad situations, name node may go down. And so, that's the reason they will maintain secondary name node. Fine, Rajesh? So this is what the functionality of name node and how the communication happens between the name node and data nodes. So it's fine, I think it's the last 5-10 minutes, we can take few questions on this, okay? So till now if you have any questions, please ask them. And don't worry about the failover management, we will discuss in the next class or probably in the day before. In the next class, okay? Just go through the good processes or fair processes as of now. So you should be fine with the reading process and writing process. Okay, I see a question here. If job is assigned to name node, will the block information from name node or other data node? No. If job is assigned to name node, will it block information. Krishna, can you type your question again? Job assigned to data now. Okay. Krishna, can you repeat your question again? So the block informations will be maintained by the data node itself. So whenever a task is given to any data node, it has to check with the data, main node, like where those blocks were available. So all the block information will be maintained only in the data node. Is that fine, Krishna? Okay. So guys, just let me know if you have any other questions. So I'm talking about data node where name node didn't assign block initially. See, the process is whenever a task is given to data node, it will search for the needed blocks. Okay, whenever a block is not available, it will ask the name node like, okay, this block is making up the file and I need this block as well. So name node will check like where this block is available and it will tell like, okay, this particular block, maybe block C is available in data node 4. Go and fetch it from data node 4. Does this answer your question? Is this you are talking about? Okay, fine. Rachesh is asking a question like, can you describe your current job role and responsibilities? So currently I'm working on Hadoop and my job role is mostly on a developer itself. I'm not taking care of any admin concepts, so I'm a developer. So my responsibilities would be mostly of writing the code itself. So as a developer, definitely we need to write few codes and we need to analyze how we have to process it, right? So that's what much about my current job role. So anything else, guys? Can we get access to recordings and slides? As content is increasing, revision would be better. Yes, you can check with the organizers. They can provide you those slides because I had shared those things with them. So you can probably get from them, okay? And coming to this HDFS, once I reach a logical end, I will share you this particular PPT, because day-to-day PPTs, I don't think it will be much more helpful. Because once two or three classes were done, I will give you all the HDFS PPTs. Because I have distributed logically into two to three different PPTs. Any documents you can share for preparing environment for application installation? Yes, once HDFS, few theoretical topics are covered, I will share you the installation process, okay? I will share you a document for that as well. So it's the name of the book is Hadoop Definitive Guide. So maybe at the end of the sessions, I will share you whatever the material I am having as well. I will try to search a few other books also for you, so that it will be helpful when you go and prepare at your home also. Yes, right up to. Welcome. Okay. So, any other questions, guys, or shall we close for today? Okay, fine. Thank you all for joining. So, guys, are you comfortable for joining tomorrow's class at 10 p.m. your time? Because tomorrow yes. Is it fine with everyone? If that's the case, we can have a class tomorrow at 10 p.m. Yes, 10 p.m. EST Krishna. Okay, fine. So let's have a session tomorrow also at 10 p.m. Okay, thank you all for joining. Have a good night. Bye-bye.
H2K Infosys provides world-class online IT training, staffing, and software testing solutions to customers worldwide. H2K Infosys, how we are different from our competitors. 100% job-oriented training, hands-on project work, cloud test lab, resume preparation and review, mock interviews, robust syllabus, one-time fee and lifetime access to classes, access to recorded sessions of live classes. H2K Infosys has won the trust of thousands of students worldwide. For a free demo class, visit us at h2kinfosys.com.